Bible says in Luke chapter 17 verse 11, it says, and it came to pass as he went to Jerusalem, that he passed through the midst of Samaria and Galilee. And as he entered into a certain village, there met him 10 men that were lepers, which stood far off. And they lifted their voices. They lifted up their voices and said, Jesus, Master, have mercy on us. Praise God. Have mercy on us. Now, it's a long portion of scripture. I'm reading just only verse 19. And he said unto him, arise, go thy way. Thy faith has made thee whole. Say, oh Lord, have mercy on me this morning. Go ahead and pray that prayer. If there is a prayer that you can pray, let God have mercy on me. Pray that prayer. Let us have mercy on you. Pray that prayer. You know the reason why you came here. Lord, have mercy on me. Pray that prayer. I cannot know what to pray. Have mercy on me this morning. Pray that prayer. Lord, have mercy. I refuse to return the same way I came. Have mercy on me this morning. Child of God, pray. Let mercy speak for you. Let mercy qualify you. Let mercy silence every other voice. Let mercy neutralize every satanic agenda. Pray that prayer. Lord, have mercy on me this morning. I have appeared yet again. Have mercy on me. Pray that prayer. Lord, have mercy. Kanda zekesha tebre kanda. Cry out for mercy. Let mercy speak for you. Let mercy silence every contrary voice. Let mercy go ahead of you. In the name of the Lord, have mercy. Remember mercy upon me as I come before you this morning. Have mercy on me. Child of God, pray. Let mercy overwhelm you this morning in the name of Jesus. Kanda zekesha tebre kanda. Lord, have mercy upon me in the name of Jesus. Let mercy bypass every judgment. Let mercy neutralize every condemnation. Let mercy move ahead of me. Let mercy make this service profitable to me. Pray that prayer. Pray that prayer. Let mercy make this service count in my destiny this morning. Child of God, pray. Let mercy silence every voice. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Let mercy make me whole. I have come here. The way I am. Let mercy make me whole. Pray. We are praying. We are praying the prayer of mercy. We are crying the cry of mercy. Let mercy speak. Let mercy speak. Let mercy speak. Let mercy speak for me. I refuse to return the same way I came. In the name of Jesus. Let mercy open the heaven for us this morning. Let mercy open the heaven for you this morning. In the name of Jesus. Let mercy release that testimony. Let mercy release that testimony. Pray. Pray for mercy. Pray for mercy. Kanda zekesha tebre kande. Rimba zekesha tarebode. Let mercy make a way for you. Let mercy make a way for you. Let mercy single you out from the crowd. In the name of Jesus. Let mercy qualify you by the power and the blood of Jesus. Let mercy qualify you in the name of Jesus. Kanda zekesha tesma brika. Rimba baba. Let mercy make you whole by the power and the blood of Jesus. In Jesus' name, we have prayed. Father, we thank you. We bless your name, oh God. Your children have come here, Lord. Let mercy amplify their voices, oh God. Father, let mercy neutralize anything that is unpleasant to this service. Let mercy scatter every network of evil by the power and the blood of Jesus. Lord, let this service count in the lives of your children. Use your servant that you have prepared to deliver what you have for your children. Father, let none of those that have come here return the same way they have come. Use everything here in this sanctuary for the glory of your name. We hand over this service into your hands, King of Kings. We neutralize every other orchestrations of evil against this service. Father, we give you all the glory. In Jesus' name we have prayed. In Jesus' mighty name we have prayed. You have a testimony. Have it registered outside there in the overflow so that you can share that testimony. As we put our hands together for the choir. Choir, take over.
Thank you so much, Pastor. Good morning to everyone. You're welcome in the presence of the Lord, where there is fullness of joy and happiness. Hallelujah. Yes, we are going to praise our God. Hallelujah. Amen. How many of you are ready to praise Him? Amen. May He bless you more and more. Amen. Okay. clap our hands.
Shut it up. open the eyes of the guy. There's no one like you.
Yeah.
Jehovah. Hallelujah. Let us continue to celebrate our God this morning. Let us worship Him and celebrate Him. Father, we bless you for your word. Your word is yes and amen. You're faithful, you're true to your promises. Join us as we make this declaration this morning. Hallelujah.
But they don't know you like we do. There is power in your name. We've heard that there is no way through. We've heard the tide will never change. Unmovable, break the unbreakable, go Together. bigger than, bigger than. Lord, even in this service, be exalted, Lord, in your power, in your majesty.
be exalted. This morning, that is our cry as we worship, as we gather, that you shall be exalted in every corner of our destinies, oh God. Be exalted in this assembly this morning. Be exalted in each of our destinies this day, oh God. Let your name receive all the glory and all the honor. In Jesus' mighty name we have worshipped. In Jesus' powerful name we have worshipped. You can go ahead and take your seats for testimonies.
Can we shout hallelujah? And a loud amen. You that the Lord has brought to this last day of our 21 days of prayer and fasting, can you say a loudest amen? The loudest amen. If you know it has not been by your muscle, can you say the loudest amen?
Amen.
Amen. Testimony time. Overcomers time. Yes, the following quickly. Come and tell us what the Lord has done. Sister Beatrice Akello, Brother Patrick, and Mrs. Sarah Changungu. You can clap for Jesus if you are clapping for Jesus. Please tell the church your names and what God has done.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
My name is Beatrice Akello. I want to thank the Lord for this church. I came here on the 4th of Jan. I came to buy the daily diet. I ended up staying after that, and I am here. And I continued with the prayers up to this day. Last night, at about 12:30 or so, I got missed calls from my siblings, one in Kampala, another in Lira. I was praying. At 1, I saw the missed calls. I called back. I was told my younger brother was involved in an accident in Lira at Oruba. He was hit by a truck. When he was hit by a truck, it threw him over and he fell on the road. So then after that, the poor thought he was dead. Then one person saw his legs were moving and they said he's alive. Let's try and we take him to the hospital. They carried him to the hospital after that. They tried to locate anyone who knows him through his phone contacts. Others were not picking. They called another cousin. She left everything that she's doing. She ran to the hospital. My sister, who he stayed with, also came in after and went to the hospital. He had a deep cut. I am told from here, the bone was open, the nose was broken, he was unconscious. They stitched all the parts. When I was called, I asked my sister if she has any MBs on her phone. She said no. I told her, I'll buy for you. I bought for her MBs at the time, and I sent her a link for no obituary, the MDH prayer. I told her, pray that prayer. I am also praying. I asked her if he is moving. She said he is very restless. I asked her, if you call his name, is he responding? She told me yes. I said, let us pray. The devil is a liar. So we prayed. I asked her, you pray. I prayed up to about 2 something, up to about 3. I called her. How is he? Did you pray? She said she prayed. Her battery was low. She took it over to charge in another room. She came back and prayed. I said, you continue praying. The Lord is faithful. He will not die. The Lord will not shame us. So I prayed the night. I said, God, the prayers will not end in tears. It will not end in a shame. You're faithful. So in the morning, I woke up, I called, I asked her, how is he? She told me he's fair. He can speak. However, his neck is stiff. He's not able to turn. They told me they'll be taking him for a CT scan today at Tatapa Hospital. It is a bit far. But the God is faithful. He didn't die on the road. People saw him. It was God.
He will not even die. Can we get up and stretch our hands? Her brother is called Ronald. There shall be no obituary. Pray that there shall be no obituary in her family. Beatrice Akello, there shall be no obituary in your family. Every grave that has been opened for Ronald or Tim, we command that grave to swallow the blood of Jesus, to swallow the blood of Jesus, to swallow the blood of Jesus. And we command O Tim Ronald to come out. We command O Tim Ronald, because our sister has come out to testify this morning, we declare his healing permanent. We declare his healing permanent by the power. In Jesus' name we pray. In Jesus' name we pray. Your brother shall not die. You shall come back and testify. In Jesus' name we pray.
Praise the Lord, church. My name is Kibori Patrick. I want to thank God that I'm alive today. I want to thank God for the Living Word Assembly, for the work it has done in my life. When we started the 21 journey, it's as if the can of worms was opened. I have been going through near-death situations. There are so many ways God has prevailed over my life. Indeed, his presence makes us whole. There are so many, but in the interest of time, I zero on one. Yes. On a Tuesday, I would be dead by now, because I entered a taxi going to Bunga. Now, after entering, where these taxis park around, those as moving machines. So one of the operators was just moving in the same direction, but all of a sudden turned, and his bucket landed on the taxi where I was, and it got smashed. You know, when you make these testimonies, it is just, we lack the words, the videotaping, otherwise.
Can you imagine? He has no words. Do you know what it means, that bucket to land on the vehicle where you are seated? And you come out alive with just a scratch? Can we give the Lord praise? Can we give the Lord glory? Can we give the Lord praise? And every power that is looking for your death, let that power go back and die. Any obituary looking for anyone here, let that obituary go back to its sender. In the name of Jesus, we declare you are hereby concealed in the blood of Jesus. No obituary in your home. There shall be no obituary for your family members. There shall be no obituary in your life. This year you are hereby garmented by the blood of Jesus. The power of death over your life this year is hereby arrested. In Jesus' name we pray. God bless you, brother.
Praise the Lord, church. My name is Sarah. I'm also here to testify of the preservation power. On the MDH of Thursday, if any of you attended, remember that was no obituary. No obituary. And you remember, as soon as Papa started, the network started acting up. So we kept switching between Facebook, YouTube, whichever was stable is what we would go with. At one point, I think in the midst of switching, he called for the mantle. I did not hear that prayer point, but when I switched back, I just saw him with a cloth on the head. I realized the time for mantle has started. I got my mantle, I placed it on my head. And after the prayers, after we rounded off the prayers, the entire MDH were about no obituary, we shall not die, we close the doors of death. As soon as MDH ended, I felt, let me take a nap, because I didn't have to be in early at work. As soon as I slept, somebody said the devil is a liar. As soon as I slept, you people, they thought they had conducted my burial in the dream. Because in the dream, according to them, I died. I'm not confessing it, I didn't die. According to them, I died in the dream. I saw their supposed lifeless body. I saw the spirit man leaving. I saw, my God. Our God is faithful. Amen. This altar is not a joke, you people. Amen. This altar is not a joke. We have been part of this ministry for 12 years as children in this ministry. But God has been faithful. At one point, I was ascending, and a voice kept shouting, take your hands off your head and shout, cry for mercy, ask God for a second chance. I'll not go in the details of what I saw, what I didn't see. But I saw myself ascending, my spirit man ascending. And the voice kept shouting, don't cover your hands, don't cover your head. Release your hands and ask for mercy, ask for a second chance. And as soon as I let my hands go like this, I said, God, have mercy on me. Give me a second chance. Immediately I descended and I saw the spirit in the dream. I saw the spirit return to the body. I woke up, I was extremely weak. You know, like how you can run a marathon the day before. Then the morning after the marathon, that's how I was feeling. It was a marathon, but I thank God. I thank God who disappointed the ordinances of the wicked over my life. And I thank God for this prayer altar. I thank God for Papa and Mama. The years we have been under their mentorship and under their father and mothership, I have never taken this altar for granted, and God help me, I will never. I encourage you to tune to MDH and revival, marriage revival.
Hallelujah. If you have understood those three testimonies, get on your feet. Let's get on our feet, thank the Lord. Let's glorify the Lord. Let's glorify the Lord. Let's glorify the Lord. It is the Lord's, by his mercies, that we are standing here. And we shall continue to stand here to glorify the Lord, to proclaim the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. No one shall die. Amongst you, no one shall die. No one here shall die. You shall not bury any of your loved ones. This year is your year to show forth the glory of the Lord in the land of the living. You shall testify of the goodness of the Lord. You shall not die. You shall stand to glorify the Lord. Father, we thank you. We give you praise for these testimonies. Your daughters and your son, King of Glory, you have preserved them from the power of the grave. Father, you have preserved them. Our sister's brother, Ronald Otim, from the power of the grave. We are saying thank you. We are saying thank you. Receive all the glory. Let's clap for Jesus. Let's give the Lord glory. Let's give the Lord praise. Our preserver, our strength, the Lord God Almighty, our strong fortress. Father, we give you praise, we give you glory. Father, we declare that because your children have come out to say thank you, let these testimonies be perfected by the power in the name of Jesus. My Father, if there be anybody that the enemy has been waiting for to be buried this year, let that barrier be canceled right now by the power in the name of Jesus. In Jesus' name we pray. Let's sing the hymn together with the choir.
Before the hills, in order.
Pick your Bible and open Exodus chapter 3, verse 1 to 15, as I invite Colonel Allen to take us through this reading.
Good morning, brethren.
Good morning.
Good morning. Brothers and sisters, did you know that every moment you live is a second chance? Our second reading is from the book of Exodus, chapter 3. We are taking it from verse 1. Moses and the burning bush. Now Moses kept the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian, and he led the flock to the backside of the desert and came to the mountain of God, even Horeb. And the angel of the Lord appeared unto him in a flame of fire out of the midst of the bush. And he looked, and behold, the bush burned with fire, and the bush was not consumed. And Moses said, I will now turn aside and see this great sight, why the bush is not burnt. And when the Lord saw that he turned aside to see, God called unto him out of the midst of the bush and said, Moses, Moses. And he said, Am I? And he said, Draw not near hither, put off thy shoes from off thy feet, for the place whereon thou standest is holy ground. Moreover, he said, I'm the God of thy father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look upon God. And the Lord said, I have surely seen the affliction of my people, which are in Egypt, and I have heard their cry by reason of their taskmasters, for I know their sorrows. God knows your sorrows. And I'm come down to deliver them out of the hand of Egyptians and to bring them up out of that land unto a good land and a large, unto a land flowing with milk and honey. May that be your portion. Unto a place of the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Amorites, the Perizzites, and the Hivites, and the Jebusites. Now therefore, behold, the cry of the children of Israel is come unto me, and I have also seen the oppression where with the Egyptians oppressed them. Indeed, our cries heard this morning. Moses is called, verse 10, Come now therefore, and I will send thee unto Pharaoh, that thou mayest bring forth my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt. And Moses said unto God, Who am I that I should go unto Pharaoh, that I should bring forth the children of Israel out of Egypt? And he said, Certainly, I'll be with you. God is with us. Amen. And this shall be a token unto thee, that I have sent thee, when thou hast brought forth the people out of Egypt. Ye shall serve God upon this mountain. And Moses said unto God, Behold, when I come unto the children of Israel, and shall say unto them, The God of your fathers has sent me unto you. And they shall say to me, What is his name? What shall I say unto them? And God said unto Moses, I am that I am. And he said, Thus shalt thou say unto the children of Israel, I am hath sent me unto you. And God said, Moreover, unto Moses, Thus shalt thou say unto the children of Israel, The Lord God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob, has sent me unto you. This is my name forever, and this is my memorial unto all generations. May the Lord bless his word.
Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. We serve a faithful God. Amen. And that faithful God has said, He has not called the seed of Jacob to seek him in vain. You have been seeking the Lord for the last 21 days in prayer and fasting. Moses was just an ordinary man, an 80-year ordinary man, until he had an encounter with God. You have had an encounter with God these 21 days. From the time Moses had an encounter with God, he became an extraordinary man. From henceforth, you have to become an ordinary person. Whether you like it or not, you become an extraordinary person from today. In Jesus' name, I pray. In Jesus' name, we pray. Please take your seats.
Hallelujah. Praise Jesus. Praise the living God. Hallelujah. We thank God for his grace. Amen. This morning, the choir is ministering in a song, a prayer received and written by our beloved mommy in the Lord. Hallelujah. We bless the Lord for his mercies over our life. The song is titled, I Want to Feel Your Touch. Hallelujah. I believe through the word and through the many preachings you've had, you know the power of the touch of God. If you're ready to experience that touch this morning, just lift up your hand to Jesus and tell him, God of Abraham, God of Isaac, God of Jacob, I want to feel your touch in my life. I want to feel your touch in my destiny. I want to feel your touch in my family, Lord. Jehovah, I need your touch this morning. Makandele bosikaya lebosataya. Rekete lebozaya lebonekaya. Hey, kaya ya ya baya. Hey, la bosile baya. Thank you, Jesus. I want to feel your touch, Jesus, all over me. I want to feel your touch, Lord, I want to feel your touch. Your hand, oh Lord, your hand of power. Your hand, oh Lord, your hand of healing. And let your power move. Move, move on over me.
Yeah. touch me, Lord. I want to feel your touch. Touch me, Lord. Touch me, Jehovah.
Touch me.
Hey, I had ever touch me. Jesus, all over me.
Yes, Lord.
I want to feel your touch. I want to feel your touch.
Don't be silent.
Lay your hand, O Lord. Your hand of power. Lay your hand, O Lord. Your hand of healing. Let your power
from their soul. Lord, touch your people. Touch your people, Lord. Touch your people. Somebody cry out for the touch of your master. Lord, touch your people. Lord, touch your people. Lord, touch your people. Name we pray. It is written, we have come unto Mount Zion, the heavenly Jerusalem, the city of the living God, unto the innumerable company of angels, and to the general assembly, and to the church of the firstborn which are written in heaven, unto God the judge of all, and to the spirit of just men made perfect, unto Jesus the mediator of the new covenant, and the blood of sprinkling that speaketh better things than that of Abel. Lord, as your people have cried out for your touch, we ask for the speakings of better things. Over their health, better things. Over their finances, better things. Over your career, better things. Over your health, better things. Over your family, better things. Over your business, better things. Lord, we ask and we we pray. And let every other voice be silenced. Let the voice of the Spirit be activated. Your name will be glorified. And let the church say, if you mean it, can you jam your hands together for Jesus? Ladies and gentlemen, it's a privilege one more time and an honor for us to have the retired Archbishop Luke Orombi. For us, it's always a pleasure to have our father and our grandfather around. If you don't mind, jam your hands as we welcome retired Archbishop Luke Henry Orombi.
Thank you very much. And will you sit down? What a blessing. And what a way to begin the new year 2023. I'm so delighted to come again after we had a fantastic time in November on the 20th. I was here, I preached, we cut a cake, we celebrated, and now we are into a new year. The gift of God for the people of God. And the reason I believe we have come into 2023 is because God wants to use us. And any humble and willing heart and an available person, God will use you. Amen. Father, thank you. Thank you for this morning. Thank you for your servants, Ben and Charity, and the team around them. You've given them leadership over this flock of yours, that they should take the lead like Moses followed the pillar of cloud, the pillar of fire, because you are taking the lead and Moses followed and the people followed. May their sight of the Lord who leads be very clear, that they may know where they are taking the flock. Amen. And the flock is here, Lord God. I want to ask you to give them sight to see, hearts to receive, and ears to listen, that they will not miss anything of God. Amen. That whatever God has for each person, they will receive it. I bless this moment of time together with them because you made it possible for me. Lord, may it be a celebration. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Beloved, Mama Phoebe was online to talk to me yesterday. This morning early, I got up. She was in church. We never talked. We shall talk after here. But I'm very sure she yesterday said I should greet you. And I think yesterday's greeting hasn't gone stale. So please receive our greetings. I am here with Dorcas, my assistant number two, and Sam, my assistant number one. And we have been in Kampala since Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, yesterday, Saturday. Today, my heart is happy to be in our church, to have fellowship with you. And then tomorrow, we will be around, God willing, through to Thursday, Friday, we go to Kasese, God willing, Saturday, Sunday, we are in Kasese, and then Monday, we swing over the lake and go back to Nebi. My heart is happy again because my daughter, Pastor Charity, is celebrating her birthday. My dear, will you come here, receive the Father's blessing before I continue? What a joy. Some people call it coincidence, but there is no coincidence with God. Father, I bless your mighty name that your daughter is carrying by faith, that she has a name written in the book of life, that you are the source of her life. that you are the one who has called her to be the person she is. A pastor, a helper, a mother, a grandmother, and may you, Lord, enable her to be a great grandmother as well. I want to bless her this morning because you brought me here deliberately to do that for her. That life will not stop on the way. That anointing will not stop on the way. That her life will be such a blessing to multitude. And may she be the carrier of a basket of bread. And that her hand is full of the bottle of wine. To feed your flock. To bless your flock. To encourage your flock. And to give hope to many. God bless you. God keep you safe. God watch over you. God multiply the works of your hands. God be their God who will look to all the time. God be your shepherd. And God be your friend. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Indeed, God is good. Please be seated. Thank you very much. I actually didn't ask you to stand up, but you did. What an honor. That is amazing. The message the Lord has given us is called to serve. Called to serve. Each of us have a calling on our lives to serve God. God is the one who calls, and he always calls. Way back in the scriptures in Genesis chapter 12, well, let's go back even to chapter 1 and 2. He called Adam. And he called Eve. They let him down. In chapter 12 of Genesis, he called Abraham to leave his people and follow him. He obeyed. Much later on, he called the prophets and he called them by name to proclaim his word. Many of them obeyed. Then he appointed kings to lead his people, and many of them led like David. Then he called the disciples much, much later on in the New Testament by name. There were 12 men having spent the whole night in prayer. Luke tells us in chapter 6, verse 12, he then called them by name. And you know that even this morning, you are called. You as a person are called by him. Your being here is not a coincidence. Your being here is not just by anything else, but by calling. I don't think any staff picked up a phone this morning and called you to come to church. Did somebody do that for you?
No.
He brought you here. He brought you here. Now let me say this. He called Moses. He called Moses at the right time. The Hebrews were in Egypt, in Africa, for 400 years plus. They were subjected to slavery and groaning and pain and labor. Now, Moses had been prepared for 80 years, 40 years in Egypt, and now 40 years in the desert, and now this is 80-year man being called by God. Now, let me affirm to you that when God calls you, death will be put at bay. Yeah. That you are called to serve the living as a living person. And I've heard the Spirit of God affirm over and over that obituary is not going to be part of your experience. Not when you're a servant. He spares you. He protects you. He watches over you. He directs your steps. Now, at 80, Moses is being called. He appeared to Moses in a flame of fire. He was burning in a bush. He was burning contentedly and self-contained. The fire that doesn't need wood or charcoal or oil, the fire that burns by itself. The bush was burning, and yet the wood was not eaten up. And Moses was intrigued and surprised to see this happening, because it doesn't happen. Normal fire needs something to eat. It can only be wood or charcoal in our context, or gas or anything else. Normal fire needs something to eat. This is abnormal. This is extraordinary different. So he had his name, and his name was being called Moses. 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 He knows your name. He knows my name. He knows our name. Now, when he calls you by name, he calls you by your beginning at conception and by your destiny. All in between, he understands. There's nothing that is hidden before God of my life. He knows. He said to Jeremiah, before you were conceived in your mother's womb, I had already known you. Before you were born, I had already appointed you a prophet to the nations. So many of us and all of us are known by God. He had his name. There was once upon a time a very corrupt guy in Jericho whose name is Zacchaeus. He even knew him by name. He knew him by name because this guy wanted to see him. His desire to see Jesus was locked in the heart of Jesus. He climbed the sycamore tree. He called him by name, Zacchaeus. Zacchaeus, come down. I want to go to your house. Let me say to you something I would believe God is going to do for you this year. He will reveal himself to you. Amen. He revealed himself to Moses. And what he revealed to Moses, I'm asking him to do to you as well, because that is important. He revealed his holiness. He revealed his holiness. He said to Moses, remove the sandals of your feet, because the land you are standing on is already permeated by my holiness. Remove your sandals. Friends, if you look at 1 Peter chapter 1 and verse 15 and 16, the God you serve is clearly portrayed by Peter in his letter when he wrote. And he wrote a letter which is very, very deep. And I want you to read this letter with me. It's Peter chapter 1 and verse 15, the first letter, these are the words. But just as he who called you is holy, so be holy in all you do. For it is written, be holy because I am holy. Be holy in your relationship in your family. Be holy in your relationship at work. Be holy in your relationship with your neighbors. Be holy in your financial dealing with people. Be holy in the way you talk. Be holy in the way you act. Be holy in your character, in all that you are. Be holy. Now, what does holiness mean? Does holiness mean sinlessness? No, it does not. Holiness means set apart for the purposes of God, consecrated for the purposes of God. So then even when you are working, you know that you are set apart by God to be in that particular place for a purpose. If you are talking, you are only talking like somebody who is set apart by God, driven by the Spirit of the Lord. When you are acting, you are acting under the anointing of God's own Spirit. Why? Because you belong to him as a holy God. You are going to be holy as well. Our God is holy in the sense that he's set apart. He is set apart, unapproachable, difficult to reach unless he reveals himself. Take off your sandals because I am the holy God. I'm talking to you. You are standing on holy ground. Secondly, he said to Moses, I'm the God of history. I am the God of history. I'm the God of your father Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. I'm the God who was and is to come. I am not just anything. I hold history in my hands. I am the God who has dealt with the first man, the father of the Hebrews. I am the God who dealt with his son. I'm the God who dealt with your patriarch, the father of the patriarchs called Jacob, the God of history. Now let me affirm to you too that you believe in a historical God. Now, these were very heavy things for Moses. He became afraid because it is dangerous to encounter God. It's not a simple thing to encounter God. He himself would have thought, I am a dead man, because the Bible says no one sees God and he lives. This is a serious encounter. But then he opened his heart. He opened his heart to Moses. He's going to say to Moses what he himself is. He says to Moses, I have seen the misery of my people in Egypt. I have seen the pain. I have seen the struggles. I've seen the poverty. I have seen the lack. And the things he saw in Egypt are even here at the doorsteps of our country, even in the city of Kampala. I have been to the slums of the city of Kampala, and I've seen the terrible hygienic condition they're living in. I've seen the helplessness of people roaming the streets of Kampala, the street kids, the prostitutes, people who are desperate for somebody to touch their lives. I have seen the misery of mankind. I have seen it. The God who has eyes is the God who sees. The God who has eyes sees you in your difficulties and in your struggle. I have seen the pain in their lives. Sometimes you are struggling with pain and you think he's not seeing, he is seeing. But also he says, I've heard their cry. I have heard their cry. Many of us cry and nobody listens. Many of us cry at night. Many of us cry alone. Pain is subjective. If you have a couple, the husband is a healthy guy, the woman is in pain, he can sleep next to his wife. Because he's not feeling the pain, he can only feel it by knowing the way the wife is struggling. But I've even seen your pain, I've heard your cry, because I know you. And the God who has ears listens to every cry that we cry, that our people cry, that our nation is crying. You know, I have been very, very burdened. You and I, if you go and see what social media is displaying for our people, young people with cell phone, with smartphone, are subjected to the rot in the Western world that is coming to us every time. What really strikes my heart is this. Why must people walk nakedly or half naked? Are we not human beings and not animals? It's okay for the dog to walk naked, for the goat to walk naked, for the cow to walk naked, but surely not a human being. Don't you have the sense that we make clothing to cover our nakedness? Because right in the beginning, when sin came into the garden, Adam and Eve were naked, and God hates nakedness. I'm told in this Bible of mine and yours too, that God had to kill animals to get the skin to wrap their nakedness, because God hates nakedness. So why should we be destroyed and brought lower, below zero by the devil, to make us walk half naked, to make us walk naked? I find that so hard for me. I find that so painful for me, because many people have forgotten the shame of nakedness. Your children are looking at that every day. Your children are suffering through those things every day. And what do you think is going on in their mind? Not very far away, Vienna College was showing us in social media lesbianism. Our own Ugandan children are now pairing up single sex, girl to girl, and maybe even boy to boy. And the whole of this immorality that is going on is a giant that is gripping our country. And it's all coming from Western world, my dear friends. We used to have dignity and decency in our nation. We used to have dignity and decency in our tribes. But today we have a people that are bent. But let me tell you, this is a calculated issue the Western world is doing. And I've done it because they know if they start with children, then the next generation is gone. It pains me to see that. It pains me to see how we, in our own context, have such a courage to steal by billions. And we don't care. And we don't mind. There are people who are earning no money, and there are people who are earning all the money. The question is, do you have a heart? Do you have compassion? The Lord said, I've heard their cry, because I know the burden they're going through. And then basically he said, I'm concerned about their suffering. I am concerned about their suffering. I've seen, I have heard, I am concerned. He's telling Moses. He's showing his heart to Moses. You know, I ask you to listen. I ask you to listen. Yes, let him touch you. But I want you to listen to his heart also. God speaks all the time. The problem is not speaking. The problem is listening. Listening, because we talk too much. We don't stop to listen to what he's saying to us. We pray endlessly and we don't stop to listen, because a lot of prayer is listening to the Father. And what is the Father saying? What is the Father saying? Now, this message came to me last night. The whole of the last 2 days, I was chewing in my heart and mulling in my heart. And I was saying to God, there must be a message for Living Word Assembly. There must be a message for you. And he was not showing me anything. Now, if you know, some of us, we go through the same labor pain like women go through the same labor pain physically. Spiritually, we do. Yes, my brother? When the Lord is formulating a message in my own heart, I'm in pain. I could not sleep. By 2 o'clock, I was awake. And I was saying, God, what is it? He said, I've shown you something. I have told you something. I said, okay, fine, Lord. Give me a little moment. Let me just close my eyes again. I did close my eyes, but I could not sleep. So I got up and took the Bible and I opened the Bible. And all the Lord is saying to us is this. There are too many bosses and very few servants. Everybody wants to be a boss. Everybody wants to be served. And the church of God has been called to serve. God is calling Moses to go and serve him. God is showing him his heart so that he can serve him. There are people in need of service. There are people in need of somebody to go take the word of God to set them free. And he said, I want to take my people free and I want to take them to the land I promised to Abraham years ago. There have been a way I want to take them home. There have been a way I want to take them home. East or West home is the best place. Now let me just ask you, Ugandans. Let me ask you, Ugandans. May you please receive the gift of the country of Uganda and own it. May you be a Ugandan who is patriotic. Don't allow Chinese to take Uganda. Do not allow Indians to take Uganda. Do not allow Western world to take Uganda. If you do, your children will be orphans. They'll be beggars. They'll be on the streets. Take your stand and take your inheritance. And this is the country of Uganda. Stand there as a servant of God through whom God can bless the next person, the next people over there, and many more people attached to God through your ministry. My friends, you're going to see that we are going to own our own country. And sadly, many of us would rather be in America, in Europe. Some of us are trying to be in China nowadays and in Japan. Dear beloved, the Lord gave us a beautiful country, a beautiful, beautiful country. This Uganda, you cannot compare it with Kenya for obvious reasons. Too much food in Uganda, too little food in Kenya. You cannot even compare Uganda to Tanzania. Tanzania is drier than Uganda. You cannot compare Uganda to Rwanda next door. Yes, they may be growing in technology, but my friend, this country is just so rich that you don't understand it. Nobody can starve in this country. There's food all over the place. Please take Uganda. And that is why God is saying to Moses, I want to take my people back. I want to take my people to the land I gave to their ancestor. I want to take them home. I want them to go and take back the land from the Hittites, the Jebusites, the Girgashites, those Canaanites. I want them to get out and my people should come in. But we are allowing the Girgashites to come in and the Canaanites to come in and the Hittites to come in and the Jebusites to come in. Why? God says, let them get out. Now the question is this. Do you know what God has buried in Ugandan soil? Even in that village of yours, you know what God has kept beneath the soil? No, we don't look for it. We don't even try. We skim on top, and when you cannot find anything else, then we go. My friend, gold is buried very deep. Oil is buried very deep. Silver is buried very deep. And unless you can dig to the depth, you can never, ever get what God has for you. God said this in his words, you will seek me and find me when you seek me with all your heart. And then when you find me, I'll show to you things which are so deep and wonderful for you. I'm a Ugandan, born in Uganda, grew in Uganda, and I want to be buried in Uganda. Because of that, I am so thankful for Ben here, for Charity here, for helping us to actually know there is something bigger and better, and that's why we come on mission to this place to unlock it for you. Unlock it for you. A lot of unlocking is going on, but do you have the key? Do you have the possibility to get your own portion as well? Do you have your possibility to get your own inheritance? These guys came, settled there. Joshua partitioned the Holy Land for them, for 12 patriarchs. And they sat there and they lived there. I am so thankful. I've been to Israel 5 times, or actually 6 times. The Jews are still there. The Canaanites are not there. The Hittites are not there. The Girgashites are not there. The Jebusites are not there. The Hebrew spoken 3,000 years ago is still spoken right now as I speak. These guys do not have land like Uganda. This guy, you have semi-desert. But they can grow anything. They can grow your bogoya. They can grow your dodo mangoes. They can grow vines. They can grow grapes. They can grow citrus fruits. Everything. They're even exporting things they're growing out. And you're wondering, Lord, what is happening here? Well, the question is, what is not happening there? The God of promise keeps his promise. I gave you this land flowing with milk and honey. And milk and honey it will be. The Arab countries now are importing fruits from Israel. Technology from Israel. The whole world is exporting agricultural understanding from Israel. Why? Because they are the descendants of Abraham. Go back home. I'm going to take you to go back home. But no, you have a problem that also Moses had. He felt very small in his own eyes. Moses looked at himself. Do you know why he's feeling very, very small? He knows his past was murderous, and he was hiding in Midian. Okay, you may be a failure. Okay, you may be a sinner. Okay, you might be terrible. But let me say, the one who forgives is God. The one who cleanses your past is God. The one who restores that which was lost is God. He's coming to Moses. He knows this is a murderer. He knows it. But he's coming to the murderer to make him an ex-murderer, to make him different. He also knew that he tried to be a deliverer of his own people. They rejected him. You remember the incident when a Jew was being fought by an Egyptian, then he killed the Egyptian? Then you remember after that, when the Jew was fighting a Jew, he tried to separate them. They just shooed him off. Who made you a judge over us? And then when he knew he actually was a murderer, and it is known, he fled. 40 years ago, he was in Midian, and God came. And God came. After 80 years, God said, you will never see death. I'm going to use you. I'm going to have you go. The failures that you went through should not determine your tomorrow. Amen. The difficulties that you went through should not determine the success coming your way. Amen. If you tried and you failed, that's okay. You can try again. There is no way you are going to succeed unless you try and then you try and then you try. Satan may give you fear. Get rid of that fear and have the boldness of the Holy Spirit. And continue to move on. He knew himself. He was a fugitive. Then he said, God, who am I? Who am I? God said, I know you. You don't have to ask me that question. I know you. And then God was saying to him that I have already sent people before. Moses, you are going to join in the line. And anybody here who is willing to join in the line of people God wants to send, say amen to yourself. Amen. And be willing and be available. God is going to use you. Don't be small in your own eyes. Look at the big God. Because if you look at yourself, you are going to be afraid of the big, powerful people and the most difficult circumstances. But your God is bigger. God is more powerful. He said to Moses, I will be with you. And because I will be with you, fear nobody. Because I will be your shield, he said to Abraham, go on and believe in me. And I will be there and I will be your God, Israel. Whatever happens to you is my concern. I will be with you. And Moses, I'm going to give you a sign. I'll send you to Egypt. And you will come back to this particular spot and you will worship me on this mountain. Amen. Now let me tell you the secret of that worship. It came later on. You've been spending 21 days in prayer, right? He went on that mountain for 40 days. And he fasted for 40 days. And he was in the presence of God for 40 days. By the time he came from the mountain back to Israelites, his face was glowing. The glory of the Lord was all over his face. He had to put a veil over him. Are you surprised that our Lord, before he began his ministry, went to the desert and spent another 40 days? And he was there for reasons which are best known to God, in preparation for what was yet to come. Moses is being prepared. The sign is going to be fulfilled. And the sign was filled on that mountain of Horeb where he was given the commandments. We'll talk about the commandments differently. But then the greatest thing that God is going to show to Moses, he never showed to Abraham, not even to Isaac, not even to Jacob, is his name. To Abraham, he gave him a name. From Abraham to Abraham. To Jacob, he gave him a name, and it is Israel. But when Jacob said, "And what is your name?" he said, "That's not your business." But to Moses, God showed himself that I am who I am. I am who I am. Moses given the privilege to know the name of God. Now, the name of God qualifies God, although you don't see his face. What does Moses mean? Moses means drawn out from the river. But Moses also means later on, you are going to draw out the people of Israel from the house of slavery to freedom. That is the name, and that's the power in the name. A while ago, I preached about names in the same pulpit. But if your name does not have a mission, ask God to give a mission to your name. Because that name is what you affirm every time people call you. When they call your name, you are affirming a mission. So Moses, I'm going to give you my name. My name is I am who I am. I was, I am, and I will be. I am the God who was with Abraham, and I'm the God who is with you, and I'm the God who will be with the Israelites when they get back to the promised land. Lord, help us to appreciate the fact that you can never leave us alone. That you walk with us, you talk to us, and we follow because we know who we are following. My own grandfather followed 12 spirits that he did not know. They were blind, they were idols, they were dangerous, they wanted to be fed with blood all the time. Every month they were fed with blood. The animals suffered for that. But we know Jehovah God. We know I am who I am, the God who revealed himself to Moses. We know the God we worship. We do not worship a God who has no name. Let me give you a bigger picture of this God much later on when he came in Jesus. When he came in Jesus, in John chapter 6, these are his words. I am the bread of life. In John chapter 8, and verse 12, he said, I am the light of the world. And whoever comes to me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. And in John chapter 10, verse 11 and 14, he said, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd knows his flock. The good shepherd lays his life for his own sheep. And then in John chapter 11 and verse 25, he says, I am the resurrection and the life. I am the resurrection and the life. Then he continues to go on in John chapter 14 and verse 6. He said, I'm the way, I'm the truth, and I'm the life. Then in John chapter 15 verse 1, he said, I'm the true vine. You are the branches. My Father is a gardener. And in Revelation, again written by John also, he said, I'm the Alpha and the Omega. I am the Alpha and the Omega. That's another study. I did it here some years back. But God wants to be a God who is revealed among his own people. One of the things I love about your church here is that you want to come and worship God whom you know. And then you feel the presence of the Holy Spirit, and God begins to move among people. Then you begin to sense the power of God in a sanctuary like this. Now, I want to say a little more about that. Friends, when you begin to sense God and feel God, will you appropriate his love for each other? For each other. Because that is the commandment he gave us in Jesus. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength, and love your neighbor as you love each other, as you love yourself. So when we begin to understand the love of God for ourselves, let's love one another. Let Living Word Assembly go out into Kampala with the code of love, binding them together. Knowing my brother is somewhere, my sister is somewhere. If I need to call so-and-so, I'll call so-and-so because I want to say ABCD to them. Bound together by the love of God because we come together and we worship together. Beloved, I am who I am is a name given to Moses of God. The year 2023 is an amazing year. Do you know God is going to make you serve at another level. Amen. God is going to make you serve at another level. Let me tell you what he has done for me standing before you. On the 2nd of January, was a Monday, he gave me another car and a brand new car. And he said this, you are on another mission. Now I have entered into my 74th birthday. And God is saying, I have a mission for you. Then I understood Moses. At 80, God is giving him assignment. Now, why did God meet Moses when he was 80? Because he was already on duty. He was already serving. He was looking after the animals of his father-in-law. If you are not on duty, you delay your next level of ministry. You need to be on duty. You need to be serving God somewhere. On Friday, I was with the IGG office and about 100 of them, everybody from a sweeper up to the top director, came in front of me and I was teaching them. I was teaching them service to the nation of Uganda. And I said, it pleases God when we serve. It pleases God when we serve. When we serve and we serve faithfully, God promotes us. Because promotion doesn't come from the east or from the west or from the south. God lifts people. God demotes people. So be diligent in what you are doing right now. Be faithful where you are. Don't be craving for it for a promotion. Don't. Because God will promote you himself. I am so thankful that when God began to show me something else, do you know what he did? He elevated a young man who was my chaplain for 7 years. Then he became a chaplain here in St. Francis in Makerere to the office of a bishop. Now this young man on Wednesday was appointed, elected as a bishop of North Kigezi in Rukunjiri. Let me say this to you. Some of us want promotion without suffering. But this young man, if you hear his story, you cannot believe it. He was thrown out of his cathedral by his own bishop. His wife and children were allowed to go in the cathedral for him. They stopped him. A very massive Muchiga warden stopped him to get inside. He was thrown out of his own school. He was a school teacher in Kigezi High School. His bishop worked his way out with the Minister of Education. He was deleted on the payroll. He struggled. But then God told him, go back and ask the bishop to forgive you. Now you think there is success without pain? You think some of you are crying for blessings? You think blessings just come? God has to prepare you to receive blessings. Amen. And part of the preparation will be pain and struggle and suffering. This guy came to Kampala here from Kigezi and he started a church with another colleague. Within 1 month, there were 500 young people in that church. Two of them were the daughters of the same bishop, my dear friend. Now God had given him ministry, but the devil is blocking his way, but he never succeeds. If the devil comes your way, he's only coming to train you to be more efficient. By the time Archbishop Nkoyoyo found him in Kabale, he was a man without any job. And he asked the bishop, can I take this guy with me to Kampala? The bishop said, even yesterday you could have taken him. Just take him to Kampala. He came to Namrembe here. That was 2003. 2004, I came to Kampala in the same office. But it began with an anointing. I'm telling you this story because there is a process that God can use. 1995, I went to Buera Nyanje to speak at a Kaim conference. This is Kigezi Ankole Anglican Youth Missioners Conference. He was an organizer. I never even knew the guy. They invited me to come. I was in Nebi as a bishop. I came, I preached, I finished. Now he was the next one to hold the microphone to speak. Then I decided I would sit there and listen to this guy. In his heart, he said, I wish the bishop could go away. Such an eloquent preacher, I'm going to follow him, I'm going to mess up things. But I sat there. I listened to the guy preach. As soon as he finished, I picked up the same microphone. I said, this young man is a rising star in Western Uganda. That evening, he and his wife came to the chapel for me to pray for. And as I laid my hands on him, the power of the Holy Spirit knocked him down. He found himself under the pew in that chapel, and he did not know what to do. The glory of God came. Now that was where his problem began. Now if you have an anointing, if you have an anointing, prepare for the war. Because the devil recognizes anointing. If you're a sweet, nice Christian, he doesn't care about you. But if he knows you're going to cause havoc in the kingdom of darkness, you're in for it, my friend. This young man came back from Bweranyanje, back to Kabale in his school, and he began to pray, and then he realized God gave him the gift of healing.
Amen.
Next to Kabale, Kigezi High School is a school called Hornby Girls School. Next to Hornby is the school for the blind. A young man came to him with a walking stick, with a white cane. He said, Onesimus, I want you to pray for me. I want to see. He prayed for this young man. His eyes were open. He threw away the cane. Now, that was the beginning of his problem. And that is how he was paying heavily, my dear friends. Hallelujah to God. The great I Am followed him in his time of struggles, saw his struggles, heard his cry, and was concerned. Then when he came to Namirembe, I met him. We worked together for 7 years. You know this guy, if you call him, and he answers your phone, you would think Bishop Orombi is the one talking. He has picked me verbatim. Here in St. Francis, you guys know what is going on. Check it out. The guy has a ministry there. But anyhow, now he's a bishop. And he said, Father, you are the only one who can prepare me with Mama to be a bishop. So we are going to prepare this guy and let him loose. But the beautiful thing about God is he never writes off anybody. God will pick you in your own simplicity, in your smallness, even in your lack of understanding and lack of qualification, God will pick you up and God will elevate you. Yesterday he told me, St. Francis is saying, what will stop you from being the next archbishop? That's a different story. I found my own son becoming the bishop even now. Now, next month, on the 10th of February, I'll be installed as the Chancellor of Muni University up there in Arua. And I also wanted to say to people, if you think you're old in your own eyes. God takes you in your old age like he took Moses at 80, and none of you is 80 years old. If you think you don't understand the Lord because you don't have the qualification, the Bible will tell you in Acts chapter 4, verse 13, they were described as unschooled, ordinary men. These were disciples, unschooled, ordinary men. The only difference was they had been with Jesus. Bold, powerful, anointed. Amen. And they never had degrees, they never had diplomas, not even certificates. Amen. That doesn't bother God, my friend. Hallelujah. God will take you for who you are because he knows who you are and will use you with the gifts he has put inside you there. And so Uganda is crying. Uganda is crying for faithful servants, not bosses. Men and women whose hands can be dirty. Men and women can walk alongside needy people. Men and women who will be there for those who are desperately looking for a touch. Men and women through whom the grace of God can pass through to bless our nation. Do you know, for me, and I want to bless you, Pastor Ben and Pastor Charity, you just don't understand what I understand about your mission. Your mission in this country is giving keys into our hands to unlock the potential of our nation. You made a sacrifice. You left your own country. You came to our own country to face us the way we are. You have made a sacrifice of your family. You have struggled all along the time. And if God is beginning to honor you, it's only the beginning. The best is yet to come. The apex of your ministry is yet to come. Thank you. Thank you for saying yes to God. To come to be among us, to live with us, to help us to unlock our minds, to unlock our attitudes, to get us free from so many garbages that is holding us. The Lord will bless you again. And the Lord will continue to bless you. Jesus has set us an example. In Matthew chapter 20, verse 28, The word says, and he's speaking, I have not come to be served, but I have come to serve and to give my life as a sacrifice to all. Jesus did not come to be served. He came to serve. He came to heal. He came to humble himself, washing the feet of the disciples, associated with the then sinners, tax collectors, prostitutes. He was one who never looked down upon a cry of a person. You call Jesus, he will stop. You call him Jesus, he will stop. You cry like the disciples cried when they were being tossed about in the storm. Lord, don't you care? Of course he does. He does. He stood up and stopped that storm and said, still, be still, waves and water, keep quiet. And it was still. A guy came to him. His daughter was struggling with death. 12-year-old woman, 12-year-old girl. He came to him and he begged him, please come home. My daughter, and only daughter, is dying. As he was going out to go and heal that girl, another woman who had struggled for so long with a flow of blood touched his garment. He stopped. He even stopped. Now there is emergency there. He's stopping here. There is another emergency here. He never passes emergency. Hallelujah. When she touched the hem of his garment, she got healed. Because she could not come openly. Why? Because she is unclean. She would not be allowed to come to the crowd. But she knew that I need to be in contact with Jesus. Then when he went there, he found the girl was dead. Everybody's wailing. He said, don't be afraid. He went into the house. He picked the girl by the hand. My child, get up. Get up. He associated with the bereaved, the struggling, the crying people. My sister from Lira was crying for her brother. Thank you for standing with her. And I believe your collective prayer has already gone ahead to Lira. And I believe that young man is receiving the healing of God from this church here. And I believe that her coming here is not by coincidence. He's coming here among a people who care. Jesus Christ washed the feet of the disciples. Jesus Christ ate with tax collectors. There was this other woman who came to him. He was in a very high-class home in a dinner. This woman, known in quote, a sinner, which means she was notoriously sinful. She walked in there. She came right to him. And he was seated down with his feet reclining at the table. She came and wept at his feet. She undid her hair and began to wipe his feet. She got a perfume bottle and broke it and poured it on his feet. Then she began to kiss the feet of Jesus Christ. Now this guy, the host, wasn't amused. He said if this man was a prophet, he would have known what kind of woman is touching him. He knew. He knows. He knows me. He knows you. He even knows the level of our sinfulness. But he set this woman free who cared to come, who cared to touch him, who cared to cry at his feet, who cared to kiss his feet. Your time with Jesus is not in vain. Amen. When you spend time with him, when you cry before him, it's not in vain. He comes to your level. He knows your problem. He knows your the depth. And I believe that for us, 2023 is going to pick us up and put us at a level. You know, now I feel like I am 50. I feel like there is so much for me to do. And it is true. There are so many things for me to do. My calendar is 2023 and 2024 is already beginning to fill up. At my age. Why? Because I'm called to be a servant. And because I am called to be his servant, I must obey him. And as long as I obey him, my life will bless multitude. I say the same to you. Obey the Lord God Almighty. Walk in faith before the Lord Almighty. Ask, Lord, what can I do? What do you have for me to do? Lord, who is it I should meet? Who is it I should call? Who is it? Two days ago, my heart, he spoke to my heart. He said, will you send this money to that desperate mother of four girl? I said, okay. So I took my phone, I got my mobile something, and I sent her the money way beyond what she was expecting. she called back. No, no, she sent me a message. She said, Dad, how does it that you know what I'm going through without me telling you? I had decided we'll never ask anybody for help, not even you. But then God, who I was talking to, has allowed you to send me money. My friend, he talks to us. He instructs us. And as long as we are obedient and we want to know his heart, he will speak to us. He will speak to you also. If you draw closer to him, if you build a relationship which is intimate with him, he is going to speak to you. He's going to give you missions to do. He's going to be there to lead you where he wants you to go, because he's God. He is the I am who I am. He is your creator and your deliverer, your savior. He is the one who has given you life. He's the one who has given you where you are. He's the one who has given you the gifts you have. He's the one who has built inside you there a connecting point with him. Be connected to him and walk in faith and walk in obedience. Beloved, my heart is released now, because I feel in my heart God has got servants here. And God is going to use his people accordingly. Because I do know very, very well. I do know very, very well. There are quite a large number of people, when they look at Bishop Orombi in the screen, they want to come to him, they want to touch him, but they don't have the opportunity. How come that you guys, when I ask your pastor, can I come to the church, he will never hesitate? Please come. Now, I am here in January the 22nd, and I've never preached in any church, by the way. Well, okay, no, let me pull that back. Yesterday I was in Watoto in Loboa. I was giving a message to the people there, because a friend of mine turned 50 and their marriage is 22 years now in marriage, and they wanted me to bless them. But a real church is your church here. So now, the reason I believe God has brought me to you is what I want to pray in your life this morning. I want to ask God to humble your heart. The Bible tells me Moses was the humblest man on the face of the earth. Humility makes you serve, my dear friend. Humility will make you kneel on your feet, will make you make your hands dirty. Humility will make you pick up somebody who doesn't look it, who smells bad and is in rags, and you will bring hope in this person, and God will dress up this person, and you can never tell who you are dealing with. It could be an angel. It could be an angel. You know this story, and I want to stop at this story. You know this story of this guy who saw God in the vision, and then he said, God, why don't you come for a visit? I want you to come home. And God said, I will come home tomorrow at 10. The guy was ready at 10. Everything sparkling. Every house, every room in the house was clean. 10 o'clock exactly, an old man at the bottom of his road was coming with a stick. And he made his way, he labored up to his home. And he came home and he said, could I have a cup of water? This man looked at him with disdain in his eyes. He said, do you know who I'm expecting to come here today? You, in your appearance, I can't give you. I'm expecting God. He turned around and he left. 11 o'clock, 12 o'clock, 4 o'clock, 5 o'clock, midnight, he appeared again in a dream. God, you're a liar, the man said. He said, I'm not a liar. God, you said you are coming at 10 o'clock. He said, I came, but you turned me off. Never turn them off. If they come to you, you never know who you are dealing with. Never judge a book by the cover. Not by the way they look or where they come from, which language they speak. The height or the whatever, no. A human being is a human being, and the angels of God can also put on a human body. Stand up, let me pray blessings on you. When he calls me, I will answer. When he calls me, I will answer. Somewhere, working on
If I suffer, let me suffer in the army.
If I suffer, let me suffer in the army. If I suffer, let me suffer in the army. I'm a soldier in the army of the Lord.
Just bow your head before God. I want you to look into yourself and feel the heartbeat that is in your body, and go deeper into the heartbeat of your spirit, where our Father wants to talk to you. I want you to be aware of His presence in the sanctuary, because He has prepared you for 21 days and He has opened you up. A lot of surgery took place the 21 days to make you vulnerable to the Spirit of God, to make you soft enough for Him to mold out of you some vessel of use, to prepare you and remove away your pride, to impart in you His own spirit of humility. For you know the Lord Jesus Christ, who was God Himself, did not count it anything to be equal with God, but He humbled Himself. He humbled Himself, became a servant, became a slave, and accepted the death on that cross. Where only criminals go, He became a criminal. Where robbers go, He became a robber. Where thieves go, He became a thief for our sake. But He had not done anything evil. He died for you. He gave His life for you. He gave His life for us, so that we can be set free with His death. So that we shall tell ourselves that I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. The life I live now, I live by faith in Him who died for me. Lord, I want to ask you right now that you will put a glow of fire of passion. Some people here, you've lost your passion even in the work you're doing. You may even want to leave and go somewhere else. But the Lord says, not yet. Be where you are, because it's out of that that I'm going to move you higher. Some of you probably have worked in the same place and it is now a tiring exercise. Oh, no way. Moses for 40 years was in the desert, the sun and the wind and the dryness. Moses stuck there until God came. God is going to come. God is going to visit you. God is going to speak to you. God is going to reveal His mission to you. God is going to reveal His name to you. And God is going to mandate you with a command to go. To go. To go. Then He says, and I am with you. And I am with you. Father God, create servants out of these men and women. Father God, create humble people out of these men and women. Father God, create people who are channels of your grace out of these men and women. Father God, may these men and women bless the city of Kampala. Father God, may these men and women bless the country of Uganda. May your hand rest upon each person here, that he may begin to sense in his heart an urgency, in her heart an urgency, a desire to serve the living God, a desire to be in partnership with the living God. When the time came, Moses went to Egypt. God demonstrated His power there. When the right time came, Moses led the people right up to the Red Sea. And then God parted the Red Sea for him. When the right time came, He walked them through the desert, giving them food, giving them water, protecting them from enemies. The same God, I am who I am, is your God, is our God. And He wants to use you. Are you willing? Are you ready? Will you surrender? Will you be there for Him? Will you say to Him, Lord, today I make a covenant with you that I shall walk with you to the end of my life. That He will hear your voice, that He will hear your heart, that He will know that you want to do a business to bless the nation of Uganda. May the blessing of God, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, rest upon you all, my beloved, now and forevermore. And the church say,
Amen. Let's keep clapping as he makes his way out. Bless you. Please, you may be seated. At this point in time, please package your offertories as we begin to wrap up. Need an envelope? Let the ushers know by raising your hands. Those following online, the instructions are on the screen for you to follow. Go ahead, package whatever you brought for your father and seal it up with a prayer. Father, what a privilege to give into your kingdom. For you told us that it is more blessed to give than to receive. Lord, as your people respond in giving, let heaven open up and let there be a rainfall over their lives. In Jesus' name we pray. God bless you. Few announcements before we draw the curtain. Our fasting is ending in the evening by 5 p.m. If it's possible, endeavor to be here live and direct. Tomorrow's MDH, early in the morning, 5 a.m. If you're attending, please make sure a bottle of oil is by your side as we pray tomorrow morning, 5 a.m. Lunch hour is ongoing Monday through to Friday. Excellent Married Men, their prayer meeting resumes for the year on Tuesday, 5 p.m. Jericho Must Fall is here Saturday, Wednesday, 5:30. Marriage Revival Program, Thursday for those who are married. Everything good can only be sustained on the altar of prayer and those trusting God for marriage. Next Sunday is our Thanksgiving service. God bless you. Do we have people giving towards the Prayer City Project? Please step out for a blessing. Church, we are going to pray for them. They are building the house of our Father. So let our prayers be collective. Begin to pray for them from your seat, wherever you are seated. As a church, we lift them up. They are building for you. Your name is the rewarder. Jehovah, reward them. Pay them back in a way that men can pay them. In Jesus' name we pray. God bless you. Can we stand up? Before I pray for you, can you open up your hands and ask God for your heart desire? The Bible says that the Lord gives grace and glory. No good thing will he withhold from him that walketh uprightly. Don't begin to talk to your Father. The Bible says, ask and you shall receive. Seek and you shall find. Knock and the door shall be opened. The Bible says, now unto him who is able to do exceedingly, abundantly, more than what we could ask or think, according to his power that is at work in our lives. As others are praying, if you are here this afternoon and you are saying, Pastor, I want to make my ways right with God. Pastor, I am in church, but Jesus is not in my heart. Make sure you don't leave here the same way you came. If that is your condition, I have the honor and privilege of praying for you. Jesus is knocking at the door of your heart. Jesus wants to take a place in your heart. Others, keep praying. God does not deny his people. Begin to conclude. In Jesus' name we pray. It is written in the word of God, I will grant you favor before the people, and when you go, you will not go empty-handed. As I am about to release you to go, your hands will not remain empty. May the God of heaven and earth, the giver of good things, may he begin to put in your hands your heart desires. Whatever your heart has been craving for, I decree that the God of heaven will put them in your hands. He will place them in your hands. He will wipe away the tears of your heart. He will exceed your expectations and turn your tears into laughter. And so shall it be. In Jesus' name we have prayed. Can you say a better amen? Can you say a better amen? Before we do the final benediction, do we have anybody today is the first time to step in here? I equally want to pray for you. Today is the first time of stepping in here. God bless you.
You are welcome in the name of the Lord. You are welcome in the name of the Lord. We can see.
Don't leave your bags behind. Don't leave whatever you came to church with behind.
You are welcome in the name of the Lord.
Our visitors, with the love of Jesus, we cherish and appreciate your fellowship. Like you heard the Archbishop say, with God, there are no coincidences. Before the foundation of the world, Jehovah knew you would be here at such a time like this. And our prayer for you as a church is that God will satisfy your heart desire. Our prayer for you as a church is that this year you will not experience the agenda of darkness. That whatever the enemy meant for evil this year, God will turn them around for your good. Our visitors, can you say a better amen? As a church, we have a token for you that we want to hand over. And that is the assignment of this sister, to hand over your token to you. Just follow her. Church, let's clap for them to go. May the Lord bless and keep you. Cause his face to shine on you. Lift up his countenance upon you. And keep you in perfect peace. As you go, may the God of Israel go with you. As you go into this new week, the strength of Israel will go with you.
The glory of Zion, we go with you into this week. Amen. Doors we open for you. Amen. Favor we answer for you. Amen. You will be remembered for good. If you are saying amen, say better amen. Amen. And the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. And surely, uncommon mercy for miracles. God bless you. Have a fantastic week.